planet is home to a multitude of tribes, each with its unique traditions and customs. Among these tribes, there are some we're not even aware of. From the mysterious Sentinel East tribe, covered in extreme seclusion, to the tiniest settlements unknown to many, we're about to embark on an epic journey to uncover the origins of these mysterious tribes. But what makes them unique, and what tales lie behind their existence? Join us as we uncover 15 of the scariest tribes you don't want to meet. Number 15, North Sentinel. The North Sentinel Island is home to the enigmatic Sentinel tribe, a group that gained widespread attention when reports surfaced of a U.S. citizen meeting his demise at their hands while attempting to breach the forbidden boundaries of their secluded habitat. This incident triggered serious discussions about the tribe, an enigma shrouded in mystery due to the scant knowledge available about them. Efforts by the outside world to engage with the Sentinels have consistently been met with fierce resistance. An illustrative example occurred in 1974 when a National Geographic director, endeavoring to create a documentary about the tribe, found himself under attack by its members. The Sentinels, known for their hostility, even went so far as to shoot arrows at an Indian aircraft flying over the island during the 2004 tsunami, all protesting any unwarranted attempts to survey their activities. At that time, the island harbored a population of 8,000 people. The historical backdrop unveils the British attempts to colonize the territory and nearby islands in the 1800s, a period marked by the Sentinels fiercely resisting external intrusion. Despite the historical context, the exact population size of the tribe remains elusive, with estimates ranging between 50 and 150 individuals. The tribe's isolation is both their shield and vulnerability. With limited exposure to the outside world, they possess minimal immunity to diseases that could be introduced from external sources. This is related to external virus has given rise to concerns among observers, fearing that any contact might expose the Sentinels to deadly viruses, potentially leading to the annihilation and extinction of the entire tribe. The delicate balance of their existence hangs on maintaining a distance from the threats brought in by the outside world. Number 14, Kowai Tribe. Deep within the thick forests of Indonesia, there exists a tribe, the last remnants of cannibals, dwelling amidst the forest. Their way of life mirrors that of their ancestors from a staggering 10,000 years ago, a time capsule untouched by the advancements of modern civilization and technology. This secluded community, numbering around 3,000 individuals, grapples with a reality that defies the conveniences of contemporary existence. Cut off from the luxuries of medical care and devoid of access to doctors, their average lifespan is around a mere 50 years. A tribe living on the fringes of imagination, armed with bows and arrows as they skillfully navigate the jungle in pursuit of sustenance. Their homes, a hut crafted from branches, serve as both shelter and a proof to the simplicity of their lifestyle. They attribute death to an entity named Kakua, a demon that assumes the image of loved ones to deceive and bring about demise. Consequently, their rituals involve sacrificing those believed to be under the influence of Kakua. The flesh of these unfortunate victims becomes sustenance for the entire clan. It wasn't until the 1970s that the outside world stumbled upon the enigmatic Kowai tribe. In a twist of fate, a group of researchers chanced upon this hidden community deep within the jungle, shrouded in mystery for millennia. As the natives laid eyes on these outsiders, their initial perception was understandably one of astonishment and fear, mistaking the researchers for spectral apparitions. It is a marvel in itself that such a prehistoric enclave persists in the midst of the internet age, untouched by the relentless march of time. This tribe's existence, unknown to the global community until recently, is a proof to the resilience of ancient traditions. The images and insights into their lives were made possible because the French guide, who led the outsiders to this hidden realm, managed to escape, becoming a part of their feasts. Thus, this tribe emerges as one of the most notorious cannibal tribes in history, captivating us with their existence on the fringes of time. Number 13, Batak people. The Batak people, constituting one of the roughly 140 indigenous communities in the Philippines, inhabit the northeastern region of Palawan, a sizable island situated in the southwest. Throughout the expanses of history, the Batak have housed themselves in the river valleys lining the coastlines of Puerto Princesa City. According to census data, their population stands at approximately 450 individuals, characterized by their huge stature, dark complexion, and distinctive curly afro-textured hair. The intriguing mystery surrounding their origins persists, as it remains uncertain whether they share ancestral ties with the Ada tribe or have roots connecting them to groups in Indonesia or the Andaman Islands. In their everyday existence, they embrace a lifestyle centered on hunting and gathering, cultivating plants from seeds, and employing a slash-and-burn agricultural methodology. Noteworthy is their engagement in trade, bartering forest and natural resources with the maritime communities of the Sulu region in exchange for manufactured goods. Contrary to the insular practices observed in some tribal societies, the Batak people exhibit a remarkable openness to interaction with outsiders. Their men in particular contribute to their community and beyond by undertaking various tasks, such as harvesting and weed clearance for neighboring groups. Additionally, they have integrated themselves into the local economy through participation in tourism activities, generating income. While the community once led a nomad existence, a shift has occurred over time. They have seamlessly transitioned into a settled way of life, establishing small villages where they produce and vend an array of goods. This transformation reflects their adaptation to a more structured and interconnected existence within the broader social fabric. Number 12, Asmat Tribe. In the mangrove thickets of Papua, New Guinea resides the Asmat Tribe, a community of approximately 65,000 individuals dwelling in villages, each boasting a modest population of around 2,000 inhabitants. Renowned for their intriguing yet chilling practices, these people have earned a notorious reputation as both headhunters and cannibals, engaging in the consumption of human flesh and brains. Astonishingly, the skulls of their unfortunate victims find utility in the tribe's rituals, serving as ceremonial objects, pillows, souvenirs, and even makeshift spoons for their meals. The people hold a distinctive belief in their origin, tracing their roots to the sacred forest. Amidst the artifacts that encapsulate the richness of their ancient heritage, one discovers intricately crafted wooden statues and sculptures, showcasing remarkable artistic skills. These relics, skillfully created, now find a home in museums across the globe, serving as tangible remnants of the tribe's culture. Contrary to the image painted by their cannibalistic practices, the tribe surprises with a peculiar sense of appreciation. Unveiling another layer of their peculiar customs, it appears that their cannibalism was not indiscriminate. Rather, it was marked by certain selectivity. The Asmat approached their cannibalistic acts with almost precision, hunting specific individuals whose names held significance. In a bizarre twist, they amassed a collection of the names of their victims, attributing a belief that by consuming the flesh of these individuals, they absorbed not only their strength but also their very essence. Delving further into this transmigration of identity, it is revealed that even the cannibals themselves did not possess individual names. Instead, they adopted the names of their victims, thereby perpetuating a cycle where the consumed became the consumer. Children within the tribe were left unnamed until they reached the age of embarking on their inaugural hunt, further emphasizing the profound role that names played in this intricate and ritual. The rules governing these games were simple. To partake in the cannibalistic rite, they needed to familiarize themselves with the name of their intended victim. Only after consuming the flesh of the chosen individual could they claim the right to adopt that person's name. Such hunts typically involved aggressive into rival villages or unsuspecting visitors, transforming the act into a suspenseful expedition. One chilling episode in Asmat history was immortalized by researcher Carl Hoffman in his book Savage Harvest. Number 11, Suri Tribe. The Suri tribe, residing in the South Sudan-Ethiopia borderlands, is a community deeply intertwined with agro practices. Nestled in the landscapes of Ethiopia's southwest, specifically within the Omozo region of the Southern Nations, Nationalities, and Peoples region. SNNPR, the Suri people, numbering approximately 34,000, are alternatively known as Surya. Within this ethnic group, a distinctive division exists, marked by two factions, the Maga and Chai, while a third subset, the Balay or Balesi or Kachipo, extends its presence into the Republic of South Sudan. The Suri people, animated by pursuits such as commerce, intermarriage, and the periodic search for greener pastures during dry seasons, exhibit a dynamic and interconnected lifestyle. Linguistically diverse, the Balay or Balesi or Kachipo group converses in a slightly different dialect when compared to their Suri counterparts. Historical echoes resonate from 1897 when Imperial Ethiopian troops made their presence known in the Suri region, marking the formal inclusion of the area into Ethiopia. In the aftermath, the region became a hotspot for cattle raids, both by Highlanders and Imperial troops stationed in newly established villages. Once characterized by a fairly political structure, led by venerable elders of the ruling age grade and chiefs or priests known as Kamoru, the Suri society has undergone a transformation. It is now seamlessly integrated into the broader administrative framework of national Ethiopia, relinquishing some of its autonomy to state control. At the spiritual forefront of the Suri people's beliefs is the supreme sky deity, recognized by the appellation Tumu. Acting as a mediator between the earthly inhabitants and Tumu, the Kamoru assumes a pivotal role in channeling the collective prayers for rain and fertility. However, Suri's religious practices tumor-related rites. Instead, they revere clan-line ancestors for their purported special abilities and enduring influence on the well-being and destinies of contemporary individuals. Over the past 15 years, a noteworthy shift in religious affiliations has occurred, with 200 to 300 Suri individuals embracing evangelical Christianity. This conversion trend is particularly pronounced in the town of Kibish, and among those who have ventured beyond their native region in pursuit of higher education, marking a distinctive chapter in the cultural evolution of the Suri tribe. Number 10. Desala Tribe. A wealth of knowledge about the Desala tribe in the vast expanse of the western Amazon basin has been unveiled through the endeavors of Brazilian explorer Sidney Pasuelo, who initiated the first contact with the tribe in 1996, and the insightful observations of journalist Paul Rafael. This unique tribe stands as one of the few remaining communities that exist in near-total isolation from the trappings of modern society, despite sporadic confrontations with neighboring groups. The main Desala tribe, comprising approximately 150 members, remains a proof to their distinct way of life. An offshoot, numbering around 24 members, emerged due to internal divisions. Some sought interaction with neighboring settlements, while the majority resisted such contact. Armed only with traditional tools like clubs and occasional use of poison springs, the tribe engages in hunting and occasional encounter. Strikingly, they use modern weaponry. Their daily routine involves up to 5 hours of labor, and communal huts, known as malakas, serve as their dwelling spaces. Although they have formal religious practices, there are reports suggesting occasional instances of slaying. Both men and women adorn themselves with red dye extracted from the ruku plant, highlighting their distinctive cultural practices. In non-compliance of the conveniences of contemporary life, the Desala tribe successfully sustains themselves by cultivating a diet that includes corn, fish, birds, wild pigs, and fruits. Their basic understanding of agriculture aids in their survival. Nevertheless, the shadow of malaria looms large, constituting the leading cause of death within their community. Through the lens of Pasuelo's exploration and Rafael's journalistic insights, the Desala tribe emerges as a captivating enclave, navigating the delicate balance between preserving their unique way of life and confronting the challenges brought about by interactions with the outside world. Number 9. Skeleton Clan. In the heart of the mountainous expanse of Papua New Guinea lies the enigmatic Skeleton Clan, a group distinguished by the very essence encoded in their genes. Within the intricate their DNA, a mysterious trait resonates, a disbelief confounding the minds of scientists. This peculiar genetic signature hints at an unknown branch of humanity, shrouded in the mysteries of evolution, or, perhaps, a lineage from an otherworldly origin. What sets this tribe apart is not merely their genetic enigma, but the startling physical manifestation of their uniqueness. The skeleton clan consciously sculpts their bodies to emulate skeletal figures, creating a spectacle where bones appear to from beneath their flesh. The most striking aspect, however, is the shining of their eyes, an effect that defies the conventional boundaries of makeup and renders contact lenses an unpopular adornment in their midst. Nestled in the mountainous embrace of Kundiawa, a settlement perched at an altitude of approximately 2,000 meters above sea level, the skeleton clan inhabits a realm distinct from the ordinary. Their physical distinctiveness extends to their interactions with neighboring tribes, marked by a historical pattern of aggression and lethal confrontations. The tribe's violent taste has positioned them as outliers even among the diverseness of indigenous communities. Remarkably, despite their reclusive tendencies, scientists managed to penetrate the veil of mystery surrounding the skeleton clan. Through painstaking efforts to secure DNA samples, researchers unveiled the existence of an unidentified gene within their genetic makeup. This revelation sparks intriguing questions about the evolution of human tribes, whether they diverged into distinct species or related to breeds of animals, or if, indeed, these tribes were dispatched to this terrestrial realm from an as-yet unexplored cosmic origin. As one contemplates the anomalies nestled within the folds of Papua New Guinea's mountains, the mind wanders into the realm of the unknown. Could there be more undiscovered facets of humanity concealed within the forests, evoking the imagery of mythical beings like King Kong roaming in distant wildernesses, far removed from the reach of our understanding? The enigma of the skeleton clan beckons us to unravel the mysteries that linger on the fringes of our comprehension. Number 8. Machu Picchu Tribe. In the depths of the Peruvian jungle, nestled near the Brazilian border, resides the enigmatic Machu Picchu tribe, also known as the Mashcapiro clan or the Cujarenu people. Secluded from the external world for an astounding 600 years, these tribal communities have held on to their ancestral existence, living in harmony with the unharmed wilderness that surrounds them. Recently, however, an unforeseen development has unraveled the veil of isolation that surrounds the Machu Picchu tribe. Fueled by a desperate need for sustenance, tools, and hunting equipment, they have resorted to invading settlements on the homes of their habitat. Tragically, this clash of worlds has led to lethal consequences. Leonardo Perez, a 20-year-old, fell victim to the tribe's quest for survival when he was fatally shot with an arrow, his equipment coveted by the tribe members. This unsettling incident follows a pattern, as evidenced by the demise of Charcoal Flores and Amitsajenka Indian, a local guide, in 2011. Charcoal Flores had spent 2 decades forging a bond with the Machu Picchu tribe, providing them with essential tools such as machetes, pots, and pads. In his attempts to persuade them to abandon their nomadic hunter-gatherer lifestyle, he became a bridge between their secluded world and the encroaching outside influences. However, tragically, it is believed that his efforts met a fatal end, marked by an arrow piercing his heart. The once impenetrable barrier between the Mashcapiro people and industrialized culture is gradually dissolving. Their interactions with other indigenous populations are multiplying, offering a glimpse into a world that has long been shielded from the march of time. Startlingly, records indicate that this year alone, the tribe's members have been cited an unprecedented 100 times, according to Patricia Balbuena, the Deputy Minister of Culture in Peru. The impact of these encounters is profound, with some tribal members abandoning their forest habitat to coexist among the nearby Yan Indians, who share a similar language. Number 7. Asaro Tribe. The Asaro Tribe, affectionately known as the Mud People. Contrary to the indigenous tribes as bloodthirsty killers, the Asaro Tribe possesses a unique and non-violent approach to dealing with formidable adversaries. Referred to as ghosts in their native tongue, they have mastered the art of inducing fear through their appearance and physical confrontation. The people, draped from head to toe in an ancient camouflage of natural swamp mud, each adorned with a demonic mud mask on their heads. With slow, deliberate movements reminiscent of an enchanted sleep, armed with bows, spears, or clubs, they create a fear and intimidating spectacle. Imagine encountering such a group in the heart of the jungle, enough to send shivers down anyone's spine. The origins of this ingenious strategy trace back to the Asaro tribe's history of frequent attacks by hostile neighboring tribes. Seizing upon the idea, they transformed themselves into spectral figures covered in mud. The ruse successfully fooled their assailants, who, mistaking them for the spirits of the fallen, fled in terror. Recognizing the effectiveness of this non-violent tactic in averting warfare, the tribe has embraced the tradition throughout generations. Crafted by skilled artisans, each mud mask is a unique work of art, featuring tusks or fangs that enhance their frightful appearance. Contrary to their intimidating exterior, the mud men of Asaro are renowned for their friendliness and artistic expression. Pink Floyd even immortalized them in one of their songs as the Mud Man. Their captivating image has not only captured the attention of the entertainment industry, but has also made them sought-after participants in movies, TV shows, and documentaries. Residing in the central part of Papua New Guinea, the Asaro tribe is just one among many remarkable indigenous communities that steadfastly maintain their cultural identity, resisting the pull of modernity as they proudly navigate through the 21st century. Number 6. Ankutsu Tribe. The Ankutsu, a small Amazonian tribe consisting of merely 3 members, currently inhabit a diminutive region within the woodland. Despite being officially recognized and legally designated by the Brazilian government, their territory is blessed in by vast sowing cattle ranches, which have supplanted the once expansive rainforests of Rondônia. These rainforests, once teeming with diverse tribes, have now given way to the encroachment of industrial activities. In the olden days, the Ankutsu's ancestors shared the vast expanse of Rondônia's rainforests with numerous tribes, coexisting harmoniously within the embrace of nature. They dwelled in modest, draw-built malocas, communal homes nestled in the same neighborhood. Proficient hunters, the Ankutsu hold a special closeness for capturing wild pigs and buffaloes. Additionally, they cultivate tiny gardens where corn and cassava flourish. Traditionally, their sustenance was derived from harvesting wild fruits and occasional fishing in the creeks. Today, they find themselves confined to a scanty area, surrounded by the imposing presence of cattle ranches. The encroachment of modernity threatens the very existence of the Ankutsu, as they are now the last remnants of their once thriving people. Despite their precarious situation, they persist in preserving their traditions. Wooden flutes, crafted skillfully by the Ankutsu, find purpose in their dances and rituals. Adorned with anklets and armbands intricately made from palm fiber, they creatively repurpose discarded pesticide containers left as garbage by the ranchers into vibrant plastic necklaces. In place of traditional shell necklaces for festive occasions, they employ urakum and nato dye to paint their bodies, infusing color and symbolism into their celebrations. As they confront the encroaching tide of modernization, their resilience and cultural expressions stand as a proof to the enduring spirit of a people on the brink of fading away. Now, it's time for today's subscriber pick. Deep within the heart of the uncharted Amazon rainforest, there existed a realm untouched by modern civilization. Hidden beneath the canopy of ancient trees and veiled in a perpetual mist, the forbidden realm was home to tribes whispered about in scary tones by the bravest of explorers. These were the scariest tribes one wouldn't dare to meet. Legend spoke of the Veiled Watchers, a tribe covered in shadows and adorned with masks carved from the gnarled wood of sacred trees. It was said that they possessed an otherworldly ability to move silently through the forest, leaving only the ominous rustle of leaves as a trace of their presence. As the sun dipped below the horizon, the Veiled Watchers emerged, haunting the darkness with their light glow. One fateful day, a fearless adventurer named Alex ventured into the heart of the Forbidden Realm, driven by an uncontrollable curiosity. Guided by the tales of the Veiled Watchers, Alex traversed the complex paths of the jungle, pushing deeper into the unknown. The air became heavy with an unspoken tension, and the forest seemed to pulse with an ancient energy. As the moon cast a frightening, Alex stumbled upon an ancient clearing. A chilling silence settled over the surroundings, broken only by the distant call of unknown creatures. Suddenly, the shadows came alive, and the veiled watchers materialized, their masks concealing expressions that hinted at a profound connection with the supernatural. Were the masks merely ceremonial, or did they hold a deeper, mystical significance? Did their presence in the forbidden realm serve as protectors, or did they harbor a darker, more ominous purpose? Share your thoughts and comments below. Number 5. Kazakh Eagle Hunters Tribe. In the captivating segment featured in the 2011 BBC Human Planet series, the nomadic Kazakh Eagle Hunters Tribe made a mesmerizing spectacle against the majestic backdrop of Mongolia's Altai Mountains. The breathtaking scene left onlookers in awe as weathered-faced father and son pairs, draped in animal skins to shield themselves from the biting cold, galloped through the vast expanse with an air of ancient skill. The duo, each mounted on horseback, commanded attention with outstretched arms, upon which rest magnificent blindfolded golden eagles. The anticipation in the air was visible as the blindfolds were ceremoniously removed, unleashing the regal raptors to soar into the heavens, a symbolic dance between man and beast. Against the sweeping plains below, the eagles descended with precision, hunting with their human counterparts. A fleeting fox ran across the rugged landscape, adding an extra layer of drama to this age-old display of skill. The setting transported spectators to a realm that seemed divorced from the constraints of the 21st century, where tradition and nature interwove seamlessly. Surprisingly, the tradition of utilizing raptors for hunting among the Kazakh people dates back to centuries, with historical references tracing back to Genghis Khan's era. Even Marco Polo chronicled the art of eagle hunting, recounting tales from the 1100s. Cave paintings from the Bronze Age immortalize the roots of techniques, revealing an enduring connection between man and bird. Today, the same Kazakh eagle hunters, who once astounded audiences on the human planet screen, graciously open their doors to curious visitors eager to delve into their ancient way of life. As one immerses in the experience, the intricate artistry unfolds, showcasing the profound bond between these modern hunters and their majestic eagles. Number 4. Quirino People. Deep within the vast and untouched expanses of the Amazon rainforest, there exists an enigmatic and resilient tribe known as the Quirino People, alternatively referred to as the Namole. These indigenous inhabitants, rooted in a wandering lifestyle, embody the essence of hunter-gatherers as they navigate the remote reaches of the rainforest. Their primary dwelling is situated within the confines of the Manu National Park, nestled in the Madre de Dios region of Peru. Speaking a distinctive dialect of the Puro language, the Quirino people number between 100 and 250, a notable increase from the meager estimate of 20 to 100 recorded in the 1970s. Intriguingly, this tribe actively shuns encounters with non-native individuals, a behavior steeped in historical trauma. The events of the 1890s witnessed the planned massacre of a substantial portion of the tribe in the upper Manu River area by the notorious Peruvian figure Carlos Fitzcarl. The survivors, exhibiting remarkable resilience, sought refuge in the remote corners of the rainforest, where they have steadfastly persisted to this day. While sightings of the Quirino people have become more frequent in recent times, particularly around the camps along the Las Piedras riverbanks, their interactions with outsiders remain minimal. During the dry season, these camps serve as fishing grounds, while in the wet season, the tribe retreats deeper into the rainforest. A peculiar note in their secluded existence emerged when, in 2013, reports surfaced of some members approaching villagers in search of sustenance. Despite their general avoidance of non-native contact, these instances hinted at a bad relationship with the surrounding communities. Recognizing the vulnerability of the Quirino people to modern diseases, the Peruvian government took a proactive step by imposing a ban on contact with them. This protective measure seeks to safeguard the tribe's unique way of life. Number 3. Mercy Tribe. The Mercy Tribe is a group of women whose specialty is unparalleled in real life. Their unique fashion sense puts them on a pedestal that even Lady Gaga would envy. Imagine lips so elegantly rolled that they can cradle an entire plate, not just any plate, but one adorned with intricate beauty composed of corn grains, bones, leaves, and berries. In the vast cultural landscape where 45 other tribes coexist, none can match the flamboyance and beauty of the Mercy women. Their portraits grace the covers of esteemed travel publications, capturing the fascination of photographers and tourists alike. The mere thought of encountering them in person sparks keen interest. However, a word of caution before venturing into their world. The men of the tribe carry a unique virus, acquired during clashes with hyenas. Their lives are marked by hardship, as they traverse different locations in search of water, engaging in territorial battles with rival tribes. Despite these challenges, they have ingeniously turned their distinctive features into a survival strategy. The tribe welcomes visitors as a source of income. Imagine this: men adorned in ceremonial attire, proudly displaying their lip plates along the roadside, ready to exchange them for compensation. Each photograph captures not just an image, but a negotiated transaction. It's a glimpse into the local show business that sustains them. Witness their unique tradition, where the lip plates are donned exclusively for the camera, offering a chance to see them featured on the coveted cover of a travel magazine. The tribe's story is not just one of survival, but of leveraging their cultural distinctiveness in a world that has come to appreciate and admire their resilience. Number 2. Mokan Tribe. The Mokan people, an Austronesian community, inhabit the mesmerizing Mergi Archipelago, a collection of 800 islands disputed between Thailand and Burma. Scholars posit that their roots trace back to southern China some 6,000 years ago, ultimately leading them to settle on diverse South Asian islands. Presently, a population ranging between 2 and 3,000 Mokan individuals resides on these islands, steering a semi-migrant existence as hunter-gatherers who intricately rely on the bounty of the sea. Within their close society, approximately 1,500 men and an equal number of women articulate themselves through a unique Austronesian language known as Mokan. Despite the deep-seated cultural richness defining their island life, an ominous shadow looms over their existence as their population undergoes a decline. The intricacies of modern immigration and property laws continually present challenges due to their wandering lifestyle. Yet, to a certain extent, they have assimilated aspects of modernity. Their children, for instance, partake in mainstream education, exposing them to cultural ideologies. However, a distinct separation emerges among those dwelling on the Surin Islands, where a more traditional lifestyle endures. These islanders, deeply twisted with the natural surroundings, subsist on the bounty of flora and fauna, employing age-old tools such as spears and nets. Noteworthy is their recent movement into local market exchanges, trading their harvested sustenance for essential goods. Despite the threats encroaching upon their age-old practices, the resilient Mokan people navigate the delicate balance between tradition and adaptation, carving a unique narrative amidst the challenges of the evolving world. Number 1. Night Marcher. Throughout the ages, recounting spine-chilling tales of ghosts has captivated audiences, serving as a cherished form of entertainment and an integral cultural tie in the historic landscape of Hawaii. The ancient structures, towering valleys, sacred cemeteries, revered temple sites, Hayao woodlands, coastal regions, and lava fields have all borne witness to recorded hauntings and beautiful spectacles. Hawaii's unbroken link to its past remains questionable, owing to the excess of sacred sites filled with in a traditional heritage. Embedded within the fabric of Hawaiian lore, a vast majority of residents have either personally encountered an episode or are acquainted with those who have. The Night Marchers, also known as Hawaii Po, occupy a prominent place in the archipelago's ghostly narratives. These entities embody a group that purposefully marches to the beat of primitive drums. Some assert that these apparitions are armed spirit warriors, adorned in ancient weaponry, helmets, and cloaks, engaged in combat or on their way to or from such endeavors. Legend extends to powerful Ali ruler spirits leading these processions to significant locations, welcoming new soldiers to the battlefield. These wandering spirits may harbor intentions of reclaiming disputed land, reliving past conflicts, or seeking revenge upon themselves. Some even suggest that the night marchers meticulously search for a portal to the afterlife. As per the tales, the night marchers traverse highly specific areas, brandishing torches aloft and repeating ancient chants. Their spectral presence is most pronounced during the nocturnal hours, with their marches synchronizing with particular moonlit nights. Although primarily associated with nightfall, there exist scattered accounts of these processions occurring in the daytime. Locals even speak of elusive footprints left by the night marchers after they have passed, despite the belief that they are inches above the earth. Encountering a night march in progress raises the question of how one should respond. According to legend, the procession should never be disrupted. Witnesses are advised to stay low to the ground, fake death, and avert their gaze, for it is said that any interference could foretell a dire fate for the intruder, a friend, or a relative. Thanks for watching. See you in the next one.